space and stay there, you need to be going at least 17,500 miles an hour. Looks pretty serene, doesn't it? But this is what 17,500 miles an hour looks like from the front of a Eurostar train on its way from London to Paris. Here comes the Channel Tunnel. There you go, and now we're in France. Paris is seconds away. So how on earth did we achieve the power to go this quickly? Tonight, in my search for the answer, I'll meet my childhood idol, a plane that can outrun a bullet. I'll be making my ears bleed in Mississippi. And I'll be annoying Mr. Prescott with my new invention. My journey to 17,500 miles an hour begins on the shimmering salt flats of Utah. God's little present to the petrol head. This is the Bonneville Speed Week. People have been coming here for 50 years, risking it all to see how much power they can squeeze from their internal combustion engines. So how good a speed machine is it?
Well, the fastest I've ever driven is 186 miles an hour on the German autobahns, and it's very, very scary. It's like sitting in a food blender that's been fired through a cannon into a wall of sound.
But now, despite the discomfort and the danger, I want to do better than that.
Well, I reckon, with a bit of luck and a fair wind, I might be able to get a personal best. I might be able to go faster than 200 miles an hour.
The rules here are really very simple. You must have a slogan on your T-shirt, and you must leave your dental floss at home. But so far as the cars are concerned, pretty much anything goes.
The Bonneville Salt Flats is the place where you can come with your hand-built toys and spend the rest of your life turning money into noise.
The organisers had said they'd get me a car, and I was very much looking forward to seeing which one of these rakish beasts it would be.
Oh dear. Not exactly a Ferrari, is it? Looks like a piece of Lego. Look at that front end. That's gonna cleave the air like a chest of drawers, that is. Be better off running.
Mind you, the people who built it are even less streamlined. Frank is too vast to get in the cockpit, so the driving these days is left to his son, Mikey.
So if I go 200 miles an hour, I get to join the 200 mile an hour club, don't I?
I don't think so.
Really?
No.
Why not?
Because in order to go 200... You got to go 250 to join that club.
I thought it was called the 200 mile an hour club.
Oh, it is.
But you have to go 250 to join.
250, yeah.
Well, that's a bit of a disappointment.
Clearly, I needed this place explaining, so I set off in search of someone English.
Jeremy, we are in one of our colonies, okay? While we're in one of our colonies, we've got to expect things a little different.
Jim here has spent his entire life savings bringing his ancient Allard to Utah. But it's ingenuity, not money, that'll get him past 200 miles an hour.
What is this here?
Well, we ran short of metal, Jeremy, and we really desperately needed to do some additions to the aerodynamics to get air into the engine.
Yeah.
And at 2 o'clock this morning, we were rather restless, and we were just walking down the main street, and you know the big Super 8 signs? One happened to come out of the sky onto us, and we felt it was an act of God, and it was intended for us to use.
You've stolen their sign.
No, it fell accidentally.
You stole their sign in the middle of the night, and you cut it up.
you could hear, there was a sort of a flapping noise, Jeremy.
Show me where it is on the car, just show me where you put it.
We're trying to get a Super 8 in the middle, but we can't.
You have credited them, look on the side.
We've given them a credit. You look down the side, the Super 8 Motel, who kindly gave us their sign.
It's not all fun and games, though.
Is there a rule on how much you can have?
You're sitting on the bottom.
The engines are stressed to their absolute limits, and when they explode, drivers are showered with burning fuel. People do get killed here. I'd therefore turned up with the sort of fireproof overalls they use in Grand Prix racing. But there was a problem.
Yeah, it's a single layer suit.
The safety people said they were so thin, I may as well race in a light Macintosh.
What's the matter with this thing?
Is that suit not good enough?
This is Formula One stuff. Yeah. Except Formula One's, they got corner workers with fire extinguishers. Here we got a fire truck in the middle. You get this thing on fire, we probably won't catch you till the 8 mile.
I've got fireproof underwear as well.
It brings it from a 5 to a 10.
And what do you want?
And if you're
20.
Yeah, if you're running fuel, we need a 20.
I feel like the kid who forgot his PE kit. I've managed to borrow a helmet from someone called Mike, and then I have this jacket, which would be very useful if you were planning on walking to the North Pole in the middle of winter. Oh, that is heavy.
Can you try to move forward on me? That's as far as you can go?
Yeah.
At last, I was ready to go. But the run before mine ended in disaster.
Seems the guy who was driving that has been fairly badly burned, so everything's stopped while they take him off to hospital.
Call 716.
716? Oh no. That's me. Now, for all its power, this thing needs a push to get it up to 60. Then it's a case of hanging on for dear life.
Right, foot down, foot half down, come on, where's the power? Where's the power? Come on! Oh, it's coming up. It's coming up, Lewis. Gear change up to 6,000. Oh! My foot is absolutely welded now. Right. Where's the second mile marker? Where's the second mile marker? There it is, 2 miles. Right. My foot absolutely buried now. Hello, please take it out of this mountain. I can't really see where I'm going because the vibration's 3 miles.
I made a complete pig's ear of the start. Just couldn't get the power down. Every time I touched the throttle, it was sliding at the back, and I thought, God, this is going to spin. I'm going to be killed. And then it just vibrates like you're going along like that. And you just can't see. I think I got the first gear change right at 6,000. How fast was it?
215!
You're kidding?
No! 215 miles an hour.
Oh, man.
Way to go, Jeremy. That's awesome.
That's fantastic.
Way to go.
3 miles. So at the 3 mile mark,
yeah,
I've been 215 miles an hour.
You were going 211, 2.25 mile.
I may have been pleased, but 215 miles an hour is some way short of our 17,500 mile an hour target. The trouble is, 215's about the limit for a petrol engine. Sure, this throaty cocktail of aluminium and steel has changed our lives, but it's only expanded our horizons by a few miles. If you're looking for the ultimate speed machine, you can do a lot better. Welcome to the afterglow world of jet power. This is an incredible sight, but sadly I have no clue what's going on here. My physics master at school said I was the stupidest person he'd ever taught. So, rather than try to bluff my way through the problem, I've sought out a man who put a jet engine in a car. And broke the sound barrier with it. Richard Noble.
Jeremy, this is very easy. The wonderful thing about the jet engine is, like all these things, it's incredibly simple. It consists of two fans. We've got one fan, which is the hot fan, on one end, and one fan, which is the cold fan, on the other end.
Okay. No, I'm lost already. So, let me give you some amazing facts. The engine in your car needs a major service once every 10,000 miles, whereas the engine on this plane needs attention once every 10 million miles. And because the plane carries so many people, its engines work out to be more economical than the motor in a Ford Fiesta.
In between the burnt in a furnace.
That's this thing, which looks like a camping stove.
No. Sorry, I'm still completely lost. But I do know this. The jet is more than a machine. It's a social phenomenon. It's done more to change society than anything else. It alone turned the planet into a global village. And it's so reliable, you can blow it up. You can shred its innards. And still, it'll stay in one piece. It's so simple that even I can understand it.
So that goes in there.
There we go, yep.
Like that. Then the camping stove.
Yep, combustion chamber, that's right.
And then that goes on the top.
That's the compressor, that's it.
Front fan.
Yep. And then you want the intake and the housing.
Lid. And then, so the air goes in there.
That's
goes
right.
On the camping stove.
Yep.
Gets hot.
Yep.
Shoots out of there, driving
that's
that
right.
fan, which then drives that one, sucking more
easy,
air.
Easy, as long as you keep the fuel coming in.
Right, so now we just need something to attach it to. Now, I should explain at this point that the noise you're hearing is not from the BBC sound effects library. It's for real.
Paper boys, pay attention. This is the throttle, and under no circumstances should you ever turn it up to the floor, because you'll be doing 70 miles an hour, and at that speed, you will go deaf. Moderation. That's the key.
I don't think this is entirely what Mr. Prescott had in mind when he asked us all to go to work on a bicycle, but, you know, needs must. You can buy the engine for £1,700, and it's only 100cc, so you don't even need a bike licence. And the great thing is it's very safe. I mean, it's not like other motorists could turn round and say, they never heard you coming.
You wouldn't hear this thing coming, though. The ultimate in jet power.
See, the thing is, this plane actually cost me my economics A-level. It did. We were supposed to read The Economist, and every single week Lockheed had an ad in there, and it was always a picture of the SR-71, and I just spent hours and hours staring at it.
There she is.
The This is the Lockheed SR-71, the Blackbird, the fastest plane ever made. When I was at school, friends had pictures of Farrah Fawcett on their bedroom walls, and they thought I was a bit strange having pictures of this instead. But I don't think I was. I mean, this thing once got from New York to London in 114 minutes.
There's the speedometer, fuel gauge, acceleration, G units. It doesn't have a speedometer.
It may have been a warplane, but it carried no bombs. It had no gun. Its job was to fly high and fast over enemy territory, taking pictures without the enemy knowing it was there. It was so secret that for 10 years, no one even knew it existed.
I made the very first flight in 1964, in December, right before Christmas, December 22nd. It was really the most secret thing going anywhere. You cannot go down to the bar at night and talk about it or even tell your wife anything about it.
It flew on the freezing edge of space, silently waging the Cold War.
Terry approaching Manfrey.
But the plane itself was white hot. The metal around the colossal engines became translucent, and as it bashed through the thin air at 2,200 miles an hour, friction made the Blackbird swell by a foot. This meant none of the panels fitted properly, so on the ground, the fuel tanks actually leak.
When you come here in the middle of the night and it's quiet and you can hear the Blackbird creaking and you can watch it bleeding, you get the impression that it's alive, that it's organic. And when you touch it, it doesn't feel like it's made of metal. It feels soft and vulnerable, like you could hurt it. But that was the great thing about this plane, because of course, you couldn't.
In its 35-year life, 1,000 missiles were fired at the SR-71. Not one even got close.
When you're at speed and altitude, remember, you're going faster than the muzzle velocity on a rifle. You're protected by the laws of physics. This thing can go anywhere it wants with total impunity.
So if it's so good, why has it been pensioned off? What's it doing in a hangar, gathering dust and leaking? If you want to see what's going on in enemy territory these days, you use a satellite. That means you have to go into space, and that means you need to do 17,500 miles an hour. And no jet can do that. What's more, if you're going into space, it's not just power that's the problem. You need an engine that can burn fuel where there's no air. You need an engine that carries its own oxygen. You need a rocket.
It may look like it was made by Mr. Heath and Mr. Robinson, but the power is just astronomical. The liquid hydrogen comes in here, and that's the second coldest liquid known to man after something else, and is converted there in a clever way into a sort of steamy gas which comes down this pipe and then is then fed up these tubes on the inside of the nozzle, which can go up to 6,000 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's hot enough to boil iron, but it can't because of all the gas in there. And then it gets back and it meets up with the liquid oxygen, which is coming down here, and then you set fire to it and all the tubes fill with flames. That jet engine we looked at earlier in the program, that develops 90,000 pounds of thrust. This churns out half a million pounds. And the space shuttle has three of them.
This is the shuttle's fuel tank. It may only be 130 miles to space, but to cover that distance, the engines will use half a million gallons of fuel. And that works out at 2 feet to the gallon. Despite the cost, however, NASA does need to test these engines once in a while. So they built this place in the wetlands of Mississippi. The first thing they installed was a huge loudspeaker, through which they played white noise to simulate the sound of a rocket.
They then sent a number of trucks in different directions out into the wilderness, and the drivers were ordered to stop when the noise levels became acceptable. This gave them an imaginary boundary line, and anyone living on the inside of it was offered a simple choice. Stay, and you'll never hear another television program as long as you live. Or take the NASA shilling and get out. No one stayed, and NASA ended up with exactly what it wanted. 125,000 acres of nothing.
They even had to move five cemeteries, because the noise they were planning on making would wake the dead. Don't worry if you can't hear what I'm saying. I couldn't even hear myself. This is the loudest sound you could possibly conceive. And, as it turns out, the cleanest.
Now, the most amazing thing is that that cloud up there, which was generated by the engine, is just a mixture of hydrogen and oxygen. It's water vapor. And in about an hour's time, someone in Mississippi is going to get wet washing. It will actually rain.
I told you! It's raining! That's unbelievable!
Oh. NASA's plane, God! It's making its own weather!
Strangely, though, despite all the power and all the fury of those incredible main engines, they only provide enough thrust to get the space shuttle 2 feet off the ground. They're only there to steer it. So what modern marvel delivers the real oomph? Well, actually, man was on the right track 500 years ago when the Chinese were messing around with their fireworks.
Indeed, the story goes that a chap called Wan Lu figured that if he got some really big fireworks and attached them to the back of a sort of chair thing, and then if he lit them, he might be able to fly. As ideas go, this one makes me want to run.
Wan did fly, but sadly from Mrs. Wan's point of view, it was in several different directions all at the same time. Pity, because the idea was spot on. Those big white tubes on the side of the shuttle, they're the key to its speed. They provide 86 million horsepower. Oh, NASA may call them solid rocket boosters, but if you talk to astronaut Tom Hendricks, he'll tell you. They're nothing more than dirty great fireworks.
The solid rocket boosters are firecrackers that we cannot turn off once they're ignited. Once you light them, you have to let them burn out.
Commander Tom Hendricks.
Tom is one of only 200 people who are qualified to fly what is basically the world's fastest airborne repeater.
When a pilot climbs into the shuttle, he or she straps it to themselves.
Go.
Eagle.
Go.
Ecom.
Go.
Booster.
Go.
The pilot starts the auxiliary power units. The vehicle comes to life.
10, 9, 8. We have a go for main engine start.
At 6 seconds before launch, the engines ignite. You feel the vibration. The vehicle begins to shudder. When the three main engines light, they are bending the solid rocket boosters about 3 feet. As the solid rocket boosters bend back to a straight up vertical position, that's when we ignite the boosters and release the bolts so that everything lifts off in a vertical condition. And this 4.5 million pound vehicle that you see sitting here lurches. You pray that the motion is up.
It is just a huge explosion, isn't it?
You're going 120 miles an hour by the time the tail clears the tower. There's no turning back. With a solid booster, like a firework, you light it and you let it burn. As we accelerate through supersonic, through the speed of sound, we're riding the thrust. The three main engines are pumping fuel fast enough to drain an Olympic-sized pool in less than a minute. We're consuming 12 tons per second during the first 2 minutes of launch.
And then when those 2 minutes are up, the solid rocket boosters are empty.
Booster officer here in Mission Control standing by for solid rocket booster shutdown and separation about 5 seconds from now.
Yeah, there's a tail off of the SRBs. And there's a flash of SRB 7.
So as pilots were relieved once the solid rocket boosters separate, because now we have more control over this awesome machine.
They may be glad to see the back of them, but those fireworks are what it took to get the shuttle to orbital speed, 17.5 thousand miles an hour. They're what it took to turn the pilots into astronauts.
Do you see the transition to Miko?
Sure does show you coming back off your chairs after the 3G. Real nice.
Funny, isn't it? That triumph of engineering is probably up there now, floating with the spirit of Wan Lu and his 500-year-old dream of rocket-propelled flight. Good night.
Next week, we'll look at what speed has done for mankind and how fast we'll be going in the future. I try my hand at laser dogfighting.
He's in the sun, I can't see him, he's in the sun.
And I buy a new garden ornament.
It's like living with a 4-year-old.